Boy, thanks everybody for coming out on a cold afternoon to talk about program for results, two-year review. We had 200 RSVPs for a topic that I thought was a little bit esoteric, and obviously there's a lot of energy around this conversation for a number of different reasons. I think one of the issues is how does the World Bank remain relevant in a world of expanding aid architecture and also making sure that it's demand-driven in the sorts of instruments and approaches that it's providing. And I know that we're sort of this program for results instrument has in essence been beta tested. It's had a couple years. It was allowed there was a 5% ceiling on the actual total of lending that could be used under this. There's been a review, an initial review, but because instruments are 3 to 5 years in length and takes a while afterwards to actually do a full-on evaluation, we're sort of really, technically speaking, sort of in the third or fourth inning of a fully understanding this. But my interest in convening this was, okay, in a world where there's a big reorg of the World Bank, there's these other actors, instruments like the Asian Infrastructure Bank that are complementary to perhaps, or perhaps competitors to traditional Bretton Woods institutions, depending on your perspective, it seems to me that there's a lot of energy in the bank system to be relevant and also be responding to clients. And so I think there's a sense that a belief that this instrument is more responsive to clients. And so one of the questions is going to be, is this instrument delivering more results than traditional instruments? And then the other question over time for the bank is, will bank shareholders, including the United States, including the U.S. Congress, and others say, well, you can do more of this and have the, and I think folks in the bank would say we'd really like to have our ceiling listed from 5% to something higher than that. And I think that's jury's still out on what's going to happen there. So without further ado, I'm going to turn the panel over. We're going to ask Fadi Asada, who's with the World Bank, to run us through a video to kind of frame up the conversation. And then we're going to hear from Fadi Asada, who's from the World Bank. And then we're going to hear from Mr. Jörg Frieden, who is the Swiss ED, but also represents a number of developing countries as well as Switzerland. And then you're also going to hear from my friend Craig Albright, who used to oversee government relations for the World Bank Group. And so he's a former World Bank staffer. He also worked on Capitol Hill. He worked in the executive branch of the U.S. government. So is going to be able to provide a little bit of a perspective of a particular shareholder, but also some of the politics of this, if I can put it that way. So without further ado, Fadia, the floor is yours.
Thank you. We thought we should hear from clients first and to start this conversation and frame it, since this is an instrument that was designed mostly in response to clients. So if it's okay with you, I think this video is self-explanatory. We will hear from three countries about their experience with PforR.
In early 2012, the World Bank Group introduced a new lending instrument, Program for Results. Program for Results, also known as PforR, disburses funds based on the results achieved. PforR helps governments improve the efficiency of their expenditure programs and achieve results by strengthening institutions and building capacity. In addition, PforR maximizes development impact by leveraging the World Bank's resources to ensure that the resources of all development partners are used to achieve the desired results.
Well, for some time, our clients were asking for our help to help them to implement specific government programs that they had. They were looking to us to help them think through how do they strengthen the quality of the programs and how do they actually improve their capacity to implement them. But our existing instruments really weren't very well suited to help us to do that, so we introduced the Program for Results.
Over the past 3 years, PforR has made very good progress. Across the globe, spanning all six regions in a range of environments from fragile states to middle-income countries, 22 operations are currently underway in a variety of sectors. For example, in Kenya, Program for Results is currently supporting the Kenyan government's National Integrated Safety Network program.
really the key attractive thing about it is the fact that you can focus on things that you want to do yourself. Like that social safety net is a policy priority for us. We had already, as a government, consciously decided that we want to do that. If it's something you own, you want to do, then PforR becomes fairly easy to implement because you're not doing anything else other than what you wanted to do yourself.
By fostering engagement at the program level, PforR creates opportunities to improve coordination and effectiveness among all parties involved.
It focuses on key concrete measures that you take to advance the project or the program that you're implementing. So there are clear, measurable indicators of progress in implementation. And that's a very important aspect of project management. And if you do that again, when you have concrete measures like that, you enhance development effectiveness.
In Vietnam, PforR is helping the government improve long-term planning and the delivery of infrastructure services.
And this PforR system will require the commitment not only at the working level who are directly involved in the investment, but also the upper levels, I mean, like central levels, have to be more responsible and also have to have a longer plans to ensure the smoothly runs of this the output expected.
PforR's inherent flexibility also helps foster partnerships towards the achievement of results.
And I think with this one, you know, this implementation of PforR, it also enhance the relationship between the bank and the government through the common output which has been agreed between the bank and the government. But it gives room for flexibilities and also more responsibility from both sides.
In Morocco, PforR is helping improve access to social services and economic opportunities.
Pour citer un exemple, je dirais que si on prend comme mesure des PPD la généralisation de la scolarisation, par exemple, ça peut être un texte de loi et on en dispose. Bon, voilà, là, la volonté politique du gouvernement est assurée. Mais quid de la mise en œuvre effective de la généralisation de la scolarisation si on ne se donne pas les moyens, à la fois institutionnels, réglementaires, mais aussi techniques, qui nous permettent d'atteindre ce résultat? Donc le PforR nous donne cette possibilité de pouvoir atteindre ces objectifs-là. Donc la question de l'enforcement devient fondamentale.
These three examples have shown how PforR has been used to strengthen the link between financing and development results. PforR is a significant step for the World Bank in the direction of providing solutions to urgent development challenges.
Well, the Program for Results has really shown some promising early results. We think that this is an instrument that has great potential in terms of really helping countries achieve better development results. We're learning as we go along, and so we really look forward to partnership with you as we take this instrument going forward.
For more information, please visit our website at worldbank.org/P4R.
Thank you. It's a pity we cannot take you all to see some of these live, because I think this is when the concept really comes alive. But I'll try to take a concept that's quite vague and share with you some of the lessons and experiences. Why did we introduce PforR? As you heard, many countries, so we have a very good instrument that we did projects, the World Bank projects. You go any country and you see them. And we had a very good instrument for doing budget support and supporting policies. But many countries were coming to us with this question, like you saw now, is that they have in Morocco, for instance, this is several billion-dollar initiative for the government to not only improve transparency, but also community engagement, et cetera. They didn't want the World Bank is supporting one part and the European Commission another and someone else, a third, each one to create a little island. They really wanted help to get better results for their program and more transparency. And this is what the type of initiatives with Program for Results can do, because instead of us going with our own set of rules, we go to a program and work with them to look at two things. Program on the institutional side, do the institutions have the ability to work well? Can they really deliver the results? Can they plan? Do they have also the checks and balances for addressing some of the fiduciary issues, some of the environmental, social issues? And once they do that, what are the results that provide the incentives for moving this program in the right direction? So at the bottom of it, really, it's about building capacity and focusing more on results. And this is something that you have seen in some of these examples. So PforR, in a nutshell, has four features. If you want to just take the takeaway for you is, one, it disburses against results, not expenditures or reimbursement. And it disburses to a specific overall program. But the disbursement to result has achieved two things. One, something very hard to measure, which is it has changed the conversations. But maybe that's the most important thing it's doing. And we've done interviews with clients. We have also, even at our board, looked at the discussions in our own management. When you're discussing a PforR, the first thing everyone talks about is what are the results? How do we get there? Do we have what it takes? And once we do that, it's the whole conversation comes around that, which is really a different focus. All our instruments try to achieve results, but by linking this financing to results, it takes it to a very different level. The second is we don't work on specific procedures, but rather on improving institutional functionality, which is, again, something we aspire to do in all our instruments, but here it is the core of the instrument. That's why it's called Program for Results. The first part of it is the program. How does the program function well? And second is, how can we achieve the most efficiency and effective results from this program? It's now 3 years old, and in 3 years, we were testing, does this work? We all have aspirations and put things on paper, and then you never know how it works in practice. We have some good news to report here is that after 3 years, 22 of these have been approved, and about 19 more are under preparation. And those that have been approved have really done well. We have done surveys and looked for results and talked to clients and talked to development partners, and the feedback is encouraging. But I sort of always like how the private sector thinks sometimes, and if we think about demand, you can ask, do people come for seconds? That's really a good test of demand. And what's interesting is where we have PforR, the countries that have started it are now on their second and third, and some on the fourth one in 3 years. So if you come back for a second take, probably it's not so bad. When we asked clients if they like this, about 80-some percent of them said that they would like to use it in the next 2 to 5 years. So this is encouraging. At the same time, we have also adopted a very interesting learning approach here, which is good because when you leave your procedures behind, you really are a lot about judgment and how you do things and how you work together. It has changed the work we work with countries. And the feedback from that has been positive. In Tanzania, actually, one of the countries in the interview said to us, we used to dread the World Bank missions. And now, actually, we look forward to them because it's kind of helping solve our problems. We don't see these as your requirements anymore, but rather how we can make our systems better. Now, they don't always still like World Bank missions, but at least that's encouraging to see. In terms of where we go with this, we looked also at the demand moving forward. When PforR was introduced, some of you have been monitoring this. I see some of the names, but many may not know this. We were asked to move cautiously, and we were asked to limit the commitments of PforR in the initial 2 years for 5% of our IDA IBRD commitments. We are now in 3 years, we actually have maintained that and have been able to implement it well, but now the demand is exceeding that, and actually we expect sort of demand to, at least in next fiscal year, to be somewhere, and even this fiscal year, to be above that 5%, and next year to be closer to about 15% or so. And moving forward, demand is, of course, a function of supply, but clearly countries are interested to explore this further. In terms of how it's doing on the institutional capacity, so we talked a little bit about the results. On the institutional capacity, we've also seen that PforR have included a lot of actions and improvements that have had spillover and effect for many aspects of the program. For example, in a few countries, we've seen monitoring and evaluation systems put in place for a very large program in which we are adding a very small proportion of financing. We've seen environmental and social units being institutionalized in road maintenance programs that will now play a much more critical role, not only for the World Bank financing or specific activities we ring-fence, but much broader. We have seen supreme audit institutes being strengthened so that they can play a bigger role in audit and implementing audit requirements. But to bring it back to results as well, we have also seen that The results have been also a big talk among governments and in our review missions. When you go there, everyone seems to know what results they have to achieve and why. And it's interesting, the dialogue within country between Ministry of Finance, Central Ministry, or subnational ministries has been, but these are the results that we have to achieve. So again, this has become something that's very commonly exchanged. And we see a range of results. We see outcomes, if you call it like child immunization. I know that there's debate what's an outcome there. We have seen improvement in nutritional status. We've seen antenatal care coverage improved. And we've seen some things that are more simpler outputs, depends on the sector. We've seen agriculture yield in some. We have also seen some of these institutional type of improvements and capacity building as key results to be achieved. So it tailors to the range of development programs, depends on the level of sophistication and maturity they have, and it adapts to each program. But it is in its early days, it's actually encouraging that we have been able to adapt to these and achieve desired results. And we hope that as we move forward, we continue to learn and we continue to sort of see progress in terms of expansion.
Okay, so Fadia, can you just explain to me what is the difference between a PforR loan or instrument, if I'm Tanzania, and just a straight up World Bank loan, and what's the difference, and why is this so great? Can you just explain that? I saw the video and I saw happy folks, but I don't fully understand. Just keep it really basic and really simple for me as to what exactly is this thing and why is this so much cooler than a straight up World Bank loan.
Okay, let's maybe take an example to do that. So in Tanzania, we have an education project, and now we are supporting their program, which is called Achieving Big Results. When we do an education project, we agree with them on a set of investments they wanted. So we rehabilitated some schools, we got some books, we trained some teachers, etc. Yeah. We finance against each of these activities when they are done, and we monitor how they are doing, and they have a set of rules they have to comply with for each and every activity.
So they don't see the money. They don't see the money until they finish the project.
No, they see the money as long as they reimburse. They spend on a training or a contract or a school. We reimburse every time you do it. We reimburse an expenditure item, okay. And the results we monitor, but they are not linked as directly to the financing. Now, again, a live example in Tanzania, the government has launched this thing called Achieving Big Results. They want to elevate the student achievements across the country. This is their national program. DFID is involved. We are involved, many others. So instead of us looking at each specific contract or expenditure, what we have done now is worked with them to see what are good results to measure, what are the changes they want in the education system, for instance, institutionalizing student testing. And reducing some of these changes, changing the way schools are managed. So this is going to be across the whole sector, and the disbursement will happen only when the attainment of school students is achieved. I hope that explains.
So let me try to say something, and then Fadia can correct me if I get it wrong. So there are three kinds of loans, right? So there's development policy loan, which is budget support. There's an investment loan, which is project specific, and then there's PforR, right? So I'll use a different example, or we can use education in Tanzania. So development policy loan will be, we the World Bank say, we want you to change X policies, right? It's very specific, and certain policies need to be changed, and as policies are changed, the money is provided, right? That's basic development policy loan, right? And then there's the investment loan, which is designed heavily upfront, very, very specific, you know, book this big that unfortunately executive directors have to review, particularly the US executive director, because it has to comply with about 150 different laws. And then that gets approved, and then they, you know, spend based on that, and they follow the playbook. And then PforR is sort of in between, right? Where Tanzania says, we have a $500 million education reform program, and the bank says, we're gonna finance 50 million of it, and your whole program has to comply with the certain rules that the bank has in order to invest in that larger program. So the bank is able to then get into that larger program, and that larger program has to comply with World Bank rules, and up front there's analyses of systems that are made public, and it's a you can kind of think of it as in between budget support and an investment loan, but it is really a different animal, right? And so that's, I think, kind of what it is for a non-technical person.
Is that correct, Fadia? Is that, does that capture it?
More or less.
Okay. Linda, is that cap?
No, I mean, I think the only thing I'll just add is PforR works, I mean, one way to think about it, just to complement this, is one works at the transaction, one works at really trying to say, you know, does this DC city have good systems in place when there is snow? One is about sort of plowing the snow, one is about the system, and one is, do we have the policies in place sort of that when things need to be changed that we have them on the books? So it is a different level of operating. But it is sort of a good way to explain it.
There's one other thing that's really important about PFAR that it's attempting to do, and it's early, but we'll see. The R is results, right? So the origin of this is to get better results. So an investment loan, the climax of the experience is getting approved by the board, right? It's approved by the board. That's the big sort of point of victory, and then the program runs. With a PforR, what you're doing is you're creating, what are they called, disbursement linked indicators or something like that? So you create a set of these, right, and then you release the money when they hit those various benchmarks. And so the climax is throughout the life of the program, it's at least that's the way it's intended to be, so that intensity of engagement is there throughout. And obviously it's linked to the results. So achieving the results is important, and it's more empowering for the country to be able to figure out how to get to the results and deliver them. So the results piece of it is important to understand, at least what it's attempting to do. And I think the instrument should be judged over time on whether or not that is happening.
Thank you. Thank you, Craig. I appreciate that. So, you're the Swiss executive director, but you represent a number of other countries on the board. Can you talk a little bit about how you're thinking about as a board member, you're thinking about this? You've obviously, this was presented to you several years ago. Switzerland's a major partner of the World Bank. You also lead on financial innovation as the country of Switzerland. There are obviously a number of concerns that have been expressed about PFAR. There have been some people who have concerns about this. But could you talk a little bit about, both from a Swiss perspective and some of the other constituencies that you represent, how they look at PFAR?
It's better, yes. So the first issue is the relevance, and I would address this as a member of the board concerned about the impact of the World Bank worldwide. Then I would look at it from the point of view of the country I represent, the country of Central Asia, different level of development, and why it seems to me the instrument is appropriate to the needs. And then a few minutes on the controversial issues that is making difficult to extend the use of PFAR, that are issues around safeguard, environmental and social safeguard on one side, and procurement on the other side, and what kind of debate we are having in the board about those issues. On relevance, the fact that reduced substantially the relevance of the bank is the fact that the bank is financing today a very tiny portion of investment programs and expenditure, a public expenditure in large part of the world, even in the poorest country like Kenya. So you cannot exercise influence on development policy and on institution by implementing in a corner of the country a perfect project. I mean, if the bank limits itself to implement project today, the influence of the bank will be limited to small corners of the developing world. So the issue we have had always is to establish linkages between the implementation of a specific project and what the country intends to do in that area, in that sector, in terms of policy, institutions, measuring results, and so on and so forth. So that's the challenge, and that's what this instrument tried to answer to put that project, that activity of the bank, in the context of the policy of the country that is, you know, building roads, promoting primary education, improving health, where the bank finances 3-5% of the whole expenditure financed by the country, and tells the government, fine, our 5% is there if you achieve with your own program a certain number of results we agree together. So that's really the central approach, and therefore, for us, the importance of the instrument to have a substantial dialogue with governments about critical policies and sectoral interventions. So that's why we see it as extremely important to avoid a marginalization of the bank in small areas that are not in a position to really influence the global picture. I go back to the country I represent, even the poorest, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan. These are countries of 5-6 million inhabitants, lost in the middle of Central Asia, almost no natural resources, live out of migration and export of some commodity, gold for Kyrgyzstan, aluminum for Tajikistan. But with a heavy inheritance, institutional inheritance of Soviet Republic, a difficult transition into more open economies and more open political systems. These countries are not used to measure results. They are very heavy input-oriented. You know, the tradition, the Soviet tradition of, you know, measuring like the World Bank, activities by inputs, right? You have the input. This is what the projects are. And in this country, where China is investing billions, and the bank, you know, I give you the example of Tajikistan today, speaking of relevance. The AIDA program for Tajikistan is 60 million a year. China has signed recently with Tajikistan an investment program of 6 billion, 100 more. And this, frankly, this is true for Comores, this is true for Guinea-Bissau, so this is true in many places, relevance, right? In this situation, what is the best approach for us is clearly to help government to implement policies with the little money we have that influence also the use of the Chinese money. So we would like to engage in a rational transport sector, planning of roads, maintenance of roads, that will apply to our $5 million investment, but will apply also to the 100, 200 million investment that the Chinese are ready to finance. Now, will the Chinese apply the same standard? And I'm back to the other issue. I'm not sure, maybe not. But if, let's keep in this example, because this for me is at the heart of the debate on standards and safeguards. The traditional approach for the bank is to say, look, in my projects, everything must be clean and effective. So on my 10 kilometers roads, we apply the highest international standards. The environment will be perfect. We have environment engineering. No forced labor. Everybody will be paid on time. Women will have their share. This is for 5-10 kilometers, right? And we apply the standard. We make sure ex ante that all standards are maintained. You have the Chinese down the road. They build 100 kilometers following government standards or their own standards. Can we have an influence? Or what is the traditional response that some of the board members would like us to apply? Don't build the 5 kilometers. Well, will this does make a difference? No, obviously not. So the issue is, standard could not be should not be applied to our own island of perfection today. We should introduce the challenge is to influence standard that could be applied also to the Chinese investment, to the government's investment, to all the investment in the sector. And those normally must be objective to the achieving the sector, must be standard defined in legislation, must be supported by monitoring of results, and so on and so forth. And this is the approach we have, part of us. Some others are more concerned, consider that if the bank dilutes its intervention in the program where the Chinese and the government and the bank put the money, we cannot ensure that in the whole program our standards are fulfilled, which is true. Now, here you have exactly this option. Either you opt for having perfect procurement and perfect standards in your own small corner, or you try to engage to improve standards across the sectors, and you will certainly have problems because here and there some of your standards will not be fulfilled, and we have a conflict.
Thank you, Jörg. The penny dropped for me now that you've explained. Thank you very much. Okay, so Craig, I'm a cognizant we've got members of Congress that have to be explained this to them. We have a U.S. Treasury that has to be explained this. The United States is particularly sensitive to issues of standards, whether it's labor standards or environmental standards. And so there's probably a temptation to say, we really ought to just focus on our 5 kilometers as opposed to the 5,000 kilometers that are going to be financed elsewhere. And so how has the U.S. government responded to this? How has the Congress responded to this dilemma?
Thanks, Dad. And let me just say thank you to you for arranging this panel. And I think you particularly in Washington, you've done probably more than most, if not all, in trying to get the bank out and talk about some of these things, which provides a service. So thank you for doing it. And thank you also for giving me the platform. This is the first time I've spoken on a panel as a former something. Usually I'm speaking as a current employer, so.
You don't have to stick to the talking points.
I do not. I feel like totally liberated. I'm gonna leave here and go to a meeting that actually is going to matter for my current job. This is like totally no stress and sort of just say what I think kind of thing. So I guess I caution my World Bank friends who are in the room, because we'll see what comes out. A couple of points that I'd like to make. So I had a really unusual World Bank employment experience. I frankly had never set foot in the World Bank until I went in to interview with Bob Zelick. And I went to the security desk and I said, hi, I'm here to meet with President Zelick. And the head of security came out and took me up to Zelick's office, and he hammered me very hard for about 30 minutes, and then I had to do some more interviewing to see if I was good enough for the job. And then once I was hired, I was de facto kind of senior staff at the World Bank, because I didn't cover much of the World Bank's portfolio at all, and don't think that I'm a development expert. The part that I did was relations with the United States, and particularly at the political level. So on that very narrow piece of what the bank did, I was basically an advisor to the president and the in-house sort of political guy for the World Bank. So for the 4 years that I was there, I had a pretty good grip on what senior management was thinking and what it was doing and the decisions that were made. And I was fortunate enough to have Jim Kim be excited enough to keep me around, so I was grateful to be able to play this kind of role for two different presidents and in the World Bank, and I got to know a lot of the senior management that way. So that's the experience that I bring. And then I left, and I'm doing something very different, but for those 4 years I was there at a high level, and normally people have to work for 30 years to be able to get into the meetings with senior management. The first day I showed up, I was there, and that was like sort of the main thing that I was doing when I was there. So I could say a couple of things. One is the World Bank is absolutely terrible at explaining itself and engaging the outside world. It's horrible at it. It's one of the worst. The IMF is worse, but the bank is really bad. And frankly, too much of my time and energy at the World Bank was taken up by fighting the bank to go out and explain itself to people. And it's was a big frustration of mine. And a lot of people who worked with me know that, including some people in the room. And an endless amount of energy needed to be taken to try to get the bank to go out and sufficiently explain itself, which made it very unusual in Washington. Most institutions in Washington are here designed to explain themselves, and they have, you know, that's like their purpose is to engage the Hill and lobby the administration and, you know, participate in the process, where the bank's view is it removes itself from that process, and its interaction is through the board and through the executive directors, and then it's up to the U.S. to deal with its own system, which to me is ludicrous, because you can do it that way if you want, but nobody else does, and you're missing a whole huge zone in Washington, D.C. that is going to impact your policies. And the bank has been very bad at it, so bad at it that activists had to shut down Washington, D.C. in order to get it to respond, you know, the WTO, Seattle, I'm not saying this is all specific to the World Bank, it's multilateral institutions, and the bank is probably better at it than the WTO or IMF or others, but it's still really bad, and they had to shut down the city to try to open it up, and they had the epiphany, oh, hey, how about if we just set up a program for these guys and they can come in and participate in the meetings? Brilliant. Now they're not shutting down DC anymore, you know. But it was that hard, and I think Jim Wolfenson made some really important steps and really tried to break that up and get the bank to explain itself more. I think Bob Zelick did a fantastic job in opening up the institution from data and information, and I can tell you from being in daily meetings with the senior management, he was hammering them to go out, and it was an expectation that they would go out and explain themselves to the world in order for him to feel like they were doing their job sufficiently. And Jim Kim has maintained the focus on and engaging externally also. So to the extent that I was successful at all, it was because I knew I had the support of the president of the bank, and if I had a problem, I ultimately could go to the president and who would generally support me. So I was in a unique position. I say all of that because when it comes to P4R, that's part of the problem. Another piece of the problem is that development's not particularly like sexy political issue. So a small percentage of the people on Capitol Hill or in the administration are thinking about it. And so when members of Congress have to make decisions about it, there's not really that much experience embedded into that. They're all very intelligent people and actually, you know, very, very skilled people who are in these positions, but they don't have any time to do anything. And so, you know, unless it's sort of shoved in front of them, they just don't absorb it. So you have this environment where people don't really understand what P4R is. So you throw the instrument into the mix that had to be approved by the Congress and the administration, and people don't particularly understand it. And what they're concerned about is that the bank is trying to get out from under its procurement rules and its safeguard rules. And part of that is because people just don't trust the bank because they don't have that experience of engaging that you do with other, certainly US government agencies, where you can go in, you can talk and have an exchange, and there's drafts that you can review and you can redline, and you know there's leaked copies or circulated copies, and it's a very iterative process. The bank's perspective is we deal with the executive directors and that's it. Part of it is understandable because there are countries where if you engage with the parliament, you actually are putting your staff at risk. And so it's hard to have a policy that's, you know, engage really heavily in the United States, but don't do it in this other country and have, you know, sort of a global policy. But I think that's part of the problem. What I'll say about P4R is that one of the things that's frustrating is that people just don't appreciate where the intensity of support is for this instrument. My experience in working with the people who are advocating for its creation and its success, a lot of them are people who are governance and accountability people. You know, they were saying this is investment lending on steroids because it gives us more ability to engage these countries and affect their systems and sort of get into the mix of the things that they're doing. Like, Jörg was saying, I mean, Linda Van Gelder, who's here, ran the governance and accountability program for the World Bank. She's now Fadia's boss, helping to implement PforR, because this is what she likes to do, you know? So the support for this is coming from that perspective, not from the perspective of, I hate these procurement rules, I hate these safeguard rules, how do we get from under them? It's the relevance issue that Jörg very accurately laid out, which I hope is being captured here, because that was about the best I've heard it explained as sort of the motivation for this. You know, that is what the bank is frustrated about, and it does want to be more relevant. So, you know, the safeguards is a box checking exercise, right? So we have to bulletproof these programs and do everything that the safeguards tell us to do and make sure it's like bulletproof. That's not what they want to do. They want to go out and have impact and change systems and make things cleaner and make things better. And if you stay within a box of, you know, box checking system to make it bulletproof so I don't get heavily investigated, that's not where they want to be. So it's not that they want to get out from under them, it's that they want to be more impactful in the way that Jörg said, and that's not understood. So I should probably stop talking because I'll go on forever, but those are a few thoughts.
Thank you, Craig. I think this is, thank you to all three of you. I think this is, I get the joke about what this is about, and I think that it's not something you can put on a bumper sticker, but I think the interest, let me try, which I think is we can either choose to do pristine 5 kilometers out of 5,000 kilometers of roads that meet a whole bunch of standards and the other 4,995 kilometers don't respond to that, or we can bring our brand, our expertise, our standards, and a little bit of money to influence the broader 5,000 kilometers. Now, there's a slight trade-off in terms of saying we may not have total control over all the standards in terms of how or but we're going to have a big seat at the table in how those 5,000 kilometers are procured or the standards that are operated on, but we're not going to have absolute control. We're going to have to give up some of our control. Is that a fair description of the trade-off that we're trying to get with PforR?
Yes, because the result against which the financing of the bank is paid out is the result of the old program, on the 5,000 kilometer and not only the 5. So we have to agree on the result of the old government program. And if those programs are achieved, or the results are achieved, we disburse. So which makes also, you know, the government must want that because we don't have financial leverage. You need a government committed to that and uses the World Bank to get competence and to have an objective assessment of results that it uses against its own vested interests.
All right, I'm just cognizant of the time, and I know, so I want to call on a couple of folks. Like I said, 200 RSVPs for a 2-year review of the program for results. I mean, obviously that there's obviously a huge energy and interest around this, more than I expected, so on a cold day, no less. So I suspect there's some opinions in the room, so could I see some hands, please? I'd like to call in a couple of folks. I see this gentleman up here. I see this woman here, and I see this woman here. We're going to have these three first. So who's got microphones? Michael Jacobs, can you come up here, please? We're going to start with this gentleman here with the coat and tie. Then this woman back there, the second to last. And then this woman here in the middle. Okay. To honor everybody, if you could just name and just keep it very brief, please.
Yeah. I'll be very brief. My name is George Kochu from Seal of Hope. My first question, I have 2 questions, in fact. My first question will be directed to George Friedman. In terms of relevance, I want to know how the World Bank will still be relevant in face of the power, financial power of China in these small countries around the world. And looking at the West perspective, is that the money that is put in place can compete with China? And from the other people aspect, is it important to turn again toward World Bank to get money? That's my question. Okay. The second one will be for Craig Albright. You are talking about the fact that the World Bank need to reach out to the opinion outside of the World Bank and discuss. I would like to know if the World Bank is doing the same thing. From what I know, they don't. But if they are doing the same thing in other countries around the world, because the program, in fact, is put in place to satisfy or come to help people in these countries. Are you reaching out to these people to know how the program is impacting them and in order for you to adjust your way? Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to have Craig jump in and respond to this now and jump the queue because I know you have to go soon.
Yep. I'd say the bank's not doing a very good job of it anywhere, so I don't think that it's not a strong suit of the bank in any particular place. I think that there's a very significant program in Europe and the United States and in Japan in terms of the donor countries. In terms of the developing countries, I think it's a different kind of challenge. I was fortunate enough to visit some of our projects and some of the countries in Africa and meet with the people that do the external work in client countries. And it's hard for them because if you're in, pick any country, I mean, I'll use Ghana as an example because one of my Ghanaian friends is here and I fell in love with Ghana, but it's relative to that particular part of Africa, it's more developed. But if you're going to go out and explain World Bank projects to people, the techniques that you would normally think of in the headquarters are irrelevant for the client country. There's no Twitter, there's no Facebook, although it's more now, but those aren't the tools you use. They're more like development practitioners than they are communications people. And going out and talking to those folks is a challenge. I will say that the bank has, part of what you're talking about is the realm of beneficiary feedback. And I will say that the bank is a pioneer in the realm of beneficiary feedback in many ways, and has figured out ways to do this more effectively over time. And I think the Open Data Initiative was part of that. I think being able to do the mapping work is part of that. Everyone talks about the example of, I forget the country, that they put the on the school, they put what, I mean, it was Uganda maybe, they put what's supposed to be in the school and the teachers and all of that. And so the parents could go and look at the list and say it's not here and then demand better results. There's a story about a young woman in the Philippines, I think it is, who through the World Bank's mapping effort, with a program and was able to petition the government based on that information that was made public through a transparency effort. And there's many other people who can speak more eloquently than me about the beneficiary feedback programs that the bank has tried to pioneer and push forward. So I give the bank credit for being one of the best at moving that forward, but it's still really hard and it's embryonic. But the point that beneficiaries empowered is a necessary element of the ecosystem for successful development, that point is definitely believed at the World Bank. So that's an achievement that I don't know how long ago that happened, but not that long ago. And trying to develop it and make it more effective is the challenge, but accepting the importance of it is was done some years ago.
Thank you, Craig. I'm gonna ask my other colleagues, Fadia and Jorg, to I know they're gonna have responses to those thoughtful questions as well, but I wanted to make sure that some other folks had a chance to ask some questions. So this woman back here.
Hi, my name is Frances Seymour from the Center for Global Development, and I'd like to hear a little bit more about the actual experience of implementing the program. And maybe, Fadia, for you, to be credible, a program like this also has to not pay if the indicators are not achieved. So I'm curious about what the disbursement rate has been compared to expectations. And if this hasn't been a problem, to what extent might we be suspicious that the indicators have been renegotiated or that the grading has been easy to move the money, as has happened in the past, like with structural adjustment? And then maybe for Jorg, I'm curious about the degree to which the kind of nightmare scenario that was in the minds of the NGO advocates has come out to play. I mean, have we in fact found out that forced labor has been used in building the roads and therefore a program has had to be suspended? Or, you know, do we feel like we know enough about what the experience is in these programs, about whether some of these bad things that we feared might happen have actually come to pass? And if not, why not? Or if so, what have we done about it? Thank you.
Great. And this woman here in the middle, Jeremiah, if you can get this.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Bremer from Arizona State University, and I guess sort of not similar, but sort of related questions. I'm wondering how the bank is engaged in the implementation. I mean, the traditional lending activity that would often be technical assistance, trust funded kinds of things that would go along, as well as bank staff engagement. And I'm wondering, you know, what form does the support actually take? And then the second question is, how do you think that the PforR program is affecting the bank's other operations? I mean, how is this feeding into the approach? And it seems like there's still PMUs, et cetera, that are all kind of heavy-handed implementation.
PMUs?
Project management unit.
Yes, okay, just.
Sorry. That's like a separate unit that's set up outside the government, basically, to implement the project, rather than being really deeply embedded, as you're describing this system is. So I'm wondering what kind of, how you see these things interacting with each other.
Okay, great. So really good, thoughtful, probing questions. So Fadia, why don't you start in terms of responding? I know there was three sets of questions I know you wanted to respond to. Then Jorg, I know you'll want to respond as well.
Okay, thanks. I just want to add first a couple of words on consultations. I guess one way to explain it is also there are several levels that it takes place at. So first, there's the whole bank engagement in the country. There's a very usually extensive consultation when you do a country program and to agree on what is in it. And usually these have 3 to 5 year horizon. And it's not only with the government, but also with other stakeholders. And it's usually quite extensive and wide. When you come to a design of an operation, again, depends on the specific tool you're using, but it also involves a consultation process. The one that's very known and usually standardized is the ones related to environmental and social aspects, but there's also a broader consultation with stakeholders on the whole design of the operation. Then the third level is as you make progress and you achieve results and sharing and making accessible information. That's, I think, what Craig touched on in terms of beneficiary. That's been an area where actually there's been a lot more science, and with IT there's been a lot of more interesting tools that have become recently available. We've seen in Pakistan using cell phones, for instance, to report on things. We've seen in others where we have used a lot of pictures and available information. But this is an area you can never do enough of. So I think this is an area where you have to accept from the beginning that the more is better, but also how you get there. But I think it's at least very well recognized, but it differs at the different levels of engagement and the type of product. Just want to clarify that. On experience with the PforR to date, it's actually quite encouraging for the initial. Now we have about 2.5 years of implementation, and a number of them that are like a year plus of implementation, more than 10. And disbursement is, we have sort of projections for each week. When you plan, you say, what do we expect it to be, which are, you know, taking reality into account. So it is actually quite on target. But your other part of the question, if it doesn't happen, do we disburse? And we have a couple of test cases where things did not happen and we did not disburse a penny. One of them 18 months, and until things happen, then the resources. So it is, again, changing how we work as well, and how you sort of also value some of these things, which is also why the discussion on results and targets probably occupies the largest part of the negotiations and discussions. And this is a good tension to have. We get always the question, so do people then lowball this or highball it? Because if it's linked to money, then everyone will want to have very easy things. We have actually a couple of cases where the government, you know, strategies are political statements, and people put, I want to just eliminate maternal mortality. And you come in saying, well, if you're going to get paid, if you eliminate that, are you really serious about this target? And then you go back and you realize this is actually way out there. It's nice as a speech, but it's not actually going to be realistic. So we've seen both extremes, and this is part of the dialogue, is to really see what's the international experience, what are the trends, what type of analysis, what type of data. It's pointing to a lot of problem in data issues in countries, which is, again, important. We've seen, actually, now there's a new PforR being prepared in a country to improve data systems and statistics, which is, for me, it was actually, I'm quite excited about that, because it means now we're valuing this enough to invest in it. So it has shown that it does have the teeth when it doesn't work, but that it actually, the myth that results-based doesn't disperse is also not true. Because for middle management, they know exactly what they have to achieve. In terms of what happened in life if it doesn't met, so we have a few things. One, people can't just change indicators. These indicators linked to resources are part of legal agreements. So yes, you can change it if life changes, but you have to go through a formal restructuring of the operation. So it's not like on this mission, I find this is low, I'll just slash it down by 10%. That doesn't happen. But you know, if there is a reason and the logical reason why you need to do it, then you have a means, but it is a formal process that's subject to reviews and explanation of the reason and what's needed there. The nightmare scenario, I think one thing we didn't mention when PforR was introduced, actually, there were some exclusions imposed on PforR to avoid any, because there were some who thought we will build dams with PforR. You will not want to do that or build an airport with PforR, because this is where you want to have your control on the inputs. You don't want to have an airport that is designed wrongly, because what does it matter if you don't disperse? You've already spent a huge amount of wasted money. So those were excluded a priori from our policy. So some things of very huge contracts or that have irreversible impacts on environment or people, we do not allow for. Because we still, at this stage, believe, at least, that we really would like to have the a priori controls on those, even though you could do that post, but it was the decision the institution made. And in terms of implementation, the best way to describe it is it moves a lot of like pre-design issues to much more problem-solving, hand-holding issue, a lot more capacity building. We just did a round of interviews with countries, a lot of requests for more capacity building and engagement from the bank. So it's in some way a bit heavier, but different in nature, because it moves from looking at transactions to seeing what are the problems, why you didn't achieve this result, how can we work together. And technical assistance can come in many ways, either through the program or with sometimes a lot of partners who are supporting that. It depends on each country's situation.
Okay, so Fadia, no nightmare scenario. So far, clean bill of health on P4R projects?
So far, well, I define nightmare, but so far, no nightmares.
Okay, but no nightmares, no. Right? So no nightmares, okay.
I can sleep well.
Oh, you're sleeping well at night, okay. So Jorg, can you just, I know these were some very thoughtful and probing questions. Could I just hear your thoughts from the board, please?
Yes, on two issues, on public policies and on safeguard. I mean, this program, this is about improving public policy and therefore maximizing the development impact of investments independently of who finances them. Mainly, they are financed by own resources. I mean, I speak about the Chinese in the case of infrastructure, but that's not the usual case. The usual case is budget, finance, expenditure, recurrent expenditure in health and education and so on. The precondition is the existence of a reform-minded technocracy in the ministry we work with. I mean, these are demand-based. They can function only if we have partners that want to improve the situation and looks for technical support and supporting legitimacy in order to implement reforms. And that's the critical point, I think. It also what probably makes technical assistance and institutional support more promising is the fact they are demand-driven by a group of people who want to achieve those results. And the fact that they shift financing on results give them, in their own system, legitimacies and leverage, discussing with politicians, other part of the administration, and so on and so forth. That's the realistic issue we are dealing with, is to put our intervention in the economic, in the political economy of the country we are dealing with. So, of course, The risk is that if the reform-minded minister goes, or if there is a change in the people that initiated this, the things could die or lose relevance and impact. That's clearly, but that's frankly is true of so many projects that last for years. We know very well how many changes in PMU and other, in a secretary of a certain ministry have had on our project. That's a vulnerability that's unavoidable in public policy anyway. You have changes in administration in your country and so on. On safeguard, I mean, let me speak about an example that I know relatively well. It's about forced labor in Uzbekistan. This has been a very controversial issue, as you know. We have had an inspection panel on that has just concluded. We set a number of recommendations. The bank faced to the challenge of child and forced labor in Uzbekistan comes up with a project. This is a traditional project that says, in the X 1,000 hectares, we contribute to cultivate through mechanization and others, there will be no forced labor. Okay? The government sign off, and we have an independent monitoring, and in that part of the country, we are safe. Now, is this enough? I mean, I'm not happy about that, because forced labor will continue elsewhere. And I don't have an instrument to discuss with government what happens outside the perimeters that I'm irrigating. So my concern, I recognize the problem, but I'm not happy with the solution that a do-no-harm safeguard gives me. I'm more and more interested to see if the government is ready to try to eradicate forced labor in Uzbekistan, and I'm looking for an instrument. For instance, a program of mechanization of the cotton sector linked to certain results that would address at the country level, with inspection by ILO and an international convention that prohibit forced labor, they will address that problem. I'm just giving you this example because it's the way I look at it. Again, to have no forced labor in what the bank does is not good enough. At the end of the project, the story is ended, right? So that's the kind of dilemma we face in the area of safeguards. We want to improve standards in the country, in the legislation, in the way the government deals with these critical issues. And we must find a way to engage the government at the level of its own global policy beyond what we can ensure in the perimeter, in the places where we do our own projects, and we check everything.
York, thank you very much. I promised everybody we'd end at 2:30. We're going a little bit over. I think this has been very enlightening. I appreciate the World Bank colleagues coming. I want to thank York in particular for coming from the board, and thank you, Fadia, and really appreciate Craig also coming back to reprise his role reprising his past life role at the bank. So please join me in thanking the panel.